Okay, guys, welcome to section two. We're going to be talking now about some other concentration terms, just in terms of conception, and then colligative properties, basically meaning properties of a solution. So far, we've discussed molarity, which of course is moles per liter. And really what we're looking at here is, this is our solute, this is our total solution. So in any calculation of concentration, that's what we're really looking at, basically. How much stuff are you putting in something, okay? So the first one that we're looking at is percent concentration. And this slide is titled percent concentration, but this covers really percent concentration as well as the other terms. But in percent concentration, people understand things by percent. If I tell you that something is 90% of something, then you know that it's most of it. If I tell you that it's 4%, you know that it's a very small amount of it. So humans generally tend to understand percents pretty well, which is why consumer companies actually use percent concentration when they're looking at their chemicals. I put on here contact solution because I know that this is one of them, but any sort of medicine that you use or toothpaste, if you look at it, it tells you exactly how much there is, and it gives you a percent. And that percent is going to be calculating the solute concentration into the total solution, okay? Maybe it's been solidified, like in the case of medicine. If you're talking about Tylenol or something, it'll tell you basically how many milligrams, or it may have a percent. Usually, if it's a solid, it's just going to tell you how many milligrams out of the total it is of that particular chemical. So, in general, though, this is the same as anything else, because what I have is my part divided by the whole times 100, which is exactly what we've been doing for all of these calculations when we're talking about percent. That is just how you figure out the percent of something, part divided by the whole times 100. The other terms that we're looking at, these terms are actually focused a lot in environmental science. So for those of you that are going on to APA or IB Environmental, you'll see these quite a bit. Parts per billion, parts per million. There's also a PPT or parts per thousand, which is used to describe things that are a little bit smaller. So really what I want you to understand from this slide is that molarity is, yes, a chemistry version of concentration, but most people use some other types of concentration calculations, percent, or these which are used for very, very small concentrations, such as what you might find in air and water pollution. Colligative properties is basically a fancy term for saying that if a solution's more concentrated, what's going to happen to it, okay? So these are properties that are dependent upon the number of solute molecules in a given volume, which, by the way, means molarity. So basically, these are properties that are dependent on the concentration. The first one is boiling point, and as we already did in the lab activity, you've seen that when something is a solution, it's going to boil at a higher temperature. So what that ultimately is really meaning for us, and I'm going to move the slide right now, so if you want to take notes on the slide, go ahead and pause it, write down the notes, and then I'm going to move the page up. Are you good? Okay, cool. So what we're really looking at here is we're saying that we have, let's say we have this beaker or this container, okay, and in it, we have a liquid, okay? And in this liquid, we'll say that it is water, it's the solvent. We have these particles, okay? So as these are starting to evaporate, they're starting to push upwards. That's supposed to be an arrow. They're starting to push upwards, okay? But here's the thing. If I have particles of something like a salt or sugar that are mixed in there, what they're actually going to do is, in some cases, block the path of the water molecules as they're trying to evaporate. So we may know, and if you don't, I'm about to tell you, that pushing down on everything is what we call atmospheric pressure, okay? And this is measured usually in ATMs or atmospheres. We'll talk a little bit more about units of pressure in the next section, but atmospheric pressure pushes down on everything. For something to be able to boil, it has to, I didn't change the font. It has to be able to essentially overcome the force of atmospheric pressure. So if things are blocking the path and these water molecules are not able to push through because they are being blocked by the solute molecules, then what you're really going to see is that the boiling point is going to be elevated, because at this point now, normally water boils at 100 degrees Celsius, or as we know here in Colorado, that's really about 95 degrees Celsius. That has to do with our altitude. We have less atmospheres pushing down, so it's already easier for water to evaporate. But when we go through that process, with a solution, it may raise up to, who knows, maybe even 104 degrees Celsius. I'm just making a guess, okay? But it raises that temperature because now I have to get the... Now? I don't know why that happened. Because now I need to get these particles moving even faster so that they can push between the red particles and actually get out. So boiling point will be elevated in the solution. So by definition, freezing point is the temperature at which something becomes solid, or essentially the temperature at which the particles slow down enough that they're not able to move past one another. So I'm going to do the same thing like I did on the last slide. I'm going to move it out of the way, and then I'm going to draw, okay? In this case, I'm going to move it this way, so you can still write if you would like to while we're going through this. So again, we talk about our beaker. Okay? And we have our liquid, and we have our particles, and just like in the last one, we have solute particles that are mixed in. They're not the same size, but let's pretend like they are, okay? If this were water, the way that it's going to freeze is that it's going to form hydrogen bonds. But it's very difficult to do that. Okay, these, sure, they're close enough. Maybe these can even form hydrogen bonds, okay? But in this location right up here at the top, we're not able to actually form any sort of hydrogen bonds because there's solute molecules that are actually blocking these water molecules from getting to each other. So essentially, freezing point is going to be affected in a very similar way. So we know that water is supposed to freeze at 0 degrees Celsius. It freezes at a slightly different temperature because of altitude, but whatever. So what ends up happening is that with a solute, it may actually freeze lower. And this really goes back to our whole road salting. Oh, misspelled it. Road salt dilemma, okay? Or the road salt idea, that if we add salt to the road, what it basically does is that it mixes with the water as it falls, turns it into a solution, lowers that boiling point because it's literally keeping the water molecules from getting to one another, so it prevents them from actually being able to freeze. All right, so that's going to be the end of the section. And so we're looking at boiling point elevation, freezing point depression is what it's called. And no, it's not just really sad. It means that we've lowered that freezing point down to a lower value. So this is the end of the section, and I will see you guys next class.